God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender.
Shine your light.
Shine your light in, let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light in, let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light
in, let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Churches all over this country today, they're doing virtual services online and everything, and it's awesome. I heard a couple weeks ago that all of us Christians almost just crashed the entire internet because of all this stuff. But you know what? There's something special about what we're doing here today.
Amen.
We are gathered together, dwelling in the spirit of unity. Amen?
Amen.
The scriptures tell us in the Psalms that's good and pleasant when we dwell together in unity. And it goes on to describe, it's like oil just running down the head and the beard of Aaron. That speaks of anointing. There's an anointing when we are gathered together in the spirit of unity in one accord just to praise the Lord, regardless of our circumstances, regardless of what's going on. Amen?
Amen.
It's wonderful. It's wonderful just praise to be here God. With you guys this morning. It's an awesome thing for us to gather and dwell in the spirit of unity. Amen?
Amen.
Later with the rain. This is an old song, an old Maranatha song.
You're my glory, you're
Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are all those things. You are our strength, our shield, our ever-present help in time of trouble, Father. Whom else do we have, Lord? Where else can we turn? Lord, just, Father, we just come to you like little children, Lord, acknowledging that you are our Father, Lord, that you are control of everything. Your control of every aspect of our lives, Father. We sing to you this morning, Father, because we believe in you, because we love you, Lord. We trust you. Lord, we need you desperately, Father. Lord, we ask you to come and fill this parking lot with your presence, Father. We don't need walls to hold you in, Lord. Permeate, Lord, our gathering, Father. Be real in this place, Lord. Lord, be real in our community, Father. We pray that you would draw men unto yourself through this crisis, Father. Lord, do a revival, Father. Make a revival happen right here in our midst, in our community, in our land, Father. Lord, we do pray that, Father, our people of this land would come to you, Lord, and would kneel before you and confess their sins, Father. Lord, we are just a nation of sin, Father, that needs to confess and repent, Lord, and to ask you to come and heal our land, Father. Again, we thank you for your steadfastness, Lord, that you are sovereign, you're in control of everything, Father. You could end this pandemic in a twinkling of an eye, Father. Lord, or you can allow it, Lord, to go for as long as your plan sees fit, Father. Lord, in the midst of it all, we know that you're working, that you're doing things, and you're working out for good all these things, Lord, to those that love you and are the called according to your purpose, Lord. So we thank you and we bless you, Lord. And we look forward to what you want to say to us this morning, Father. So, Lord, just open our hearts to hear from you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take a minute now and greet everyone. No, I'm kidding. Thanks for coming out today. And those of you who are tuning in live via Facebook, we miss you guys. We love you guys. We're thinking about you, praying for you. And we just look forward to the day we can all gather again. Amen. So today is a special day. So interesting that all of these things would be taking place in this time, this month. You know, this is a very special month for Christians around the world. And I've been telling you guys and encouraging you to just take a special emphasis in your homes, in your workplaces, wherever you go, to just seek the Lord and pray and even fast, because the Lord's return is near. And when we see these things happening around us, we know that our redemption is even nearer and it's very close. We're certainly living in interesting times. You know, we look around and you see the kinds of restrictions and the things that people are saying. We'd say, wow, it's in many ways, it's a privilege to be alive for such a time as this. These things were prophesied long ago. And now we're living in a day, and you think about it, here in Florida, we've recently been put on lockdown. We've been given the stay-at-home order, many states before us, almost the entire nation. It won't be long before the entire nation is really in lockdown. And you think about what kind of times that we're living, and it might cause a lot of fear and anxiety. And we have been encouraging one another not to be afraid and to be encouraged. And, you know, for us as believers, this is a time when we exercise faith over fear. Amen? We have this blessed hope. And our hope is in heaven. It's anchored there. And when we see these things happen, we know that we're going to be with the Lord very soon. And so we can look around us and we can endure, if you will, the trials that we're going through as a world, as a nation, with anticipation, with excitement. You know, that sounds strange to the world. You go, what? You're excited for what? And we're excited not because of our circumstances. We're not excited, even in our hearts. Sometimes it's just we have to, encourage ourselves. He says, look, even your heart sometimes will be discouraged. So Take heart, there's one that's greater than your heart. We are excited because of the Lord. So we have this hope in Him, and it's not in us, it's not in our world, and it's not in our circumstances. And you think about all that's taking place. And so today is Palm Sunday. It's a time that we remember and we are reminded of how the Lord entered into Jerusalem riding a donkey. He didn't come riding a horse. But you think about that. 2,000 years ago, Jesus died on a cross. He was buried. And then 3 days later, it says He rose from the dead. That's what we celebrate on Easter. We're going to be celebrating that next week. No matter where we are, we're going to celebrate it. The church is not bound to walls. It's not bound to a location. We are the people of God, the church, the ecclesia. We are the church. And so wherever we are, we're going to worship. And we're going to worship and we're going to celebrate Easter next week, no matter what. And Easter is a time that we celebrate Christ's resurrection. And we know there too that after He rose from the dead, it says that He walked on the face of the earth and He appeared to hundreds of people for a period of about 40 days. And then it says He ascended into heaven and He was taken up in the clouds. And in that story, it tells us that two angels appeared to the disciples as they were looking up as their Lord was taken up into heaven. And it tells us there that the angels said to the disciples, "Hey, what are you looking at? As you've seen the Lord go up in glory, taken up in the clouds, so in the same manner He's going to come back. As He ascended, He's going to descend. He's going to come back in the clouds. And you and I know that this time when He returns, He's going to come riding a white horse." And there's a contrast there from the time when He first came to the time when He will come again. And I wanted to start with that, and I'm going to read that to you. It tells us in great detail in Revelation 19 what that will look like. Revelation 19 verse 11 says, "Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And He who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness He judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on His head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except Himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and His name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed Him on white horses. Now out of His mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it He should strike the nations. He Himself will rule them with a rod of iron, and He Himself treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. And He has on His robe and on His thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." Amen. This is speaking about Jesus Christ, the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the earth. Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now, when He comes again, when He returns, notice, when He returns for the second time, it will be to judge the nations. He is coming to rule. And you compare these things with what we're going to be studying and looking at in the way that He first came when He entered into Jerusalem. The world is certainly ripe for judgment. And you and I hope for that return of Christ, because He's also going to bring with judgment everlasting peace. But He will judge the nations with a rod of iron. But we won't have this peace until Christ returns, until He comes and establishes it on this earth. And we know in the end, as I read last week, that there will be a false sense of peace in the end. There'll be a treaty made, especially with Israel. And you look at these signs in the times, it will be a false sense of peace, and it will be administered not only in Israel, but throughout the world. But only Christ can offer true peace. And only Christ will ever keep peace. Amen? Peace is always short-lived. And today, on Palm Sunday, this is a day we celebrate, remember when Christ entered into Jerusalem riding a donkey. When I think of Palm Sunday, I'm always reminded that Christ's first coming was a humble servant of the Lord Almighty who came bringing peace. He came lowly, riding a foal. You think about that. He came in humility to display his love towards us from heaven above to the earth below, to bring us the gift of eternal life. And he gave his life in order to be able to give us that gift, to provide for us, because you and I would never be able to pay the price and the penalty for our own sins. And so Christ became that sacrifice for us. He himself bore our shame. That's what Christ did in his first coming. And he was mocked and he was misunderstood. But as a sign of his promise that he would return, he left us another gift. Not only has he promised us the gift of salvation, but he's given us a gift, the gift of the Holy Spirit, as a seal, as a mark of our salvation. And you will know if you are saved. You will know if, when Christ returns, if you should be afraid, if you should be ashamed. Because if you have been born again and filled and sealed by the Holy Spirit, you will not have to be ashamed at his coming, because you know that he is pleased with his own work. The work of Jesus Christ on the cross is finished. It was accomplished and it was done for all of us. So when he comes, we have a blessed hope. It's not in ourselves. It's in what he has already accomplished. And so this story of Christ entering into Jerusalem is a reminder that he is still actually wanting to make peace with those who are hostile towards him. The enemies of the cross, the enemies of God, those who have sinned. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But yet every day that goes by, these are days where we realize and where we understand Christ still wants to make peace. This is why we're waiting. You think about all that's going on in the world today. It's nice for us to be able to gather. We celebrate what Christ accomplished. But think about those who do not celebrate such things, who have not yet realized that. It's important for us to know that the same Christ that entered into Jerusalem and who brought peace to you and me and has brought peace into our hearts is wanting to do the same work in their hearts while we wait. We don't want them to meet Christ on the white horse before they meet Christ on the donkey. Amen? We want them to know Christ who came humbly, bringing that sacrifice of God's love and demonstration of his sacrifice and that perfect gift of eternal life. Whoever would believe him, whoever would receive him, he gives the gift of eternal life. These are times where we'd say the time is short and we have to bring that message. So when you think about Palm Sunday, remember this. Jesus offers the gift of eternal life to all who would receive him. They didn't fully understand what was happening. And I'll talk about that here now as we look at one of the passages that explained to us what it was like that day when Jesus entered into Jerusalem and he was celebrated as the Christ. They celebrated him as the King, but they didn't understand what kind of peace he was actually going to bring. Now, this story is written in all four Gospels. I'm going to focus on the one in John chapter 12. So if you have your Bible, you can go ahead and turn there with me. John chapter 12, it's a shorter recollection of these events, but there's a few details in there I'd like to highlight. This is where Jesus enters into Jerusalem riding a donkey, bringing peace. So John chapter 12, verse 12, beginning there, it says, "On the next day, the large crowd who had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him and began to shout, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." And then Jesus, finding a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." And these things his disciples, as it says there, did not understand at the first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written of him, that they had done these things to him. It's Palm Sunday. We remember what happened on that day. Jesus entered into Jerusalem. But let me give you a little bit of context to what was taking place in Jerusalem. Remember that this is shortly before the great feast, Passover. So there would have been large crowds. Hundreds of thousands of people would have flooded towards Jerusalem to be there to celebrate. And so you think about the thousands and thousands of people pouring into the city. The 10th day of Nisan, according to our calendar, would be like the 6th day of April, really Monday. But we celebrate it on Sunday, Palm Sunday. This is 4 days before the Feast of Passover. Passover is a celebration to commemorate their great victory and deliverance by God through the work of Moses in Egypt. Remember that? The exodus from Egypt into the wilderness, they were supposed to be on their way to the promised land. Who delivered them? God did. They celebrate that. And this is the time when each family would choose a lamb. And as the blood was placed over the doorpost, and that angel of death came, killing the firstborn of all those in Egypt, the Israelites were spared. And in the same way, we know that Jesus Christ is our Passover lamb. And leading up to this, notice what's taking place. You think about the context here and the thousands of people who have gathered for this event. Not only that, we know this, that Daniel gave a prophecy. And he talked about 69 weeks, 69 7-year periods. And he talks about how these years are going to pass before your king's going to come. It's 483 years from March 14th. 445, fifth year of BC before Christ, it tells us that Artaxerxes gave the charge to go and rebuild Jerusalem. And then think about this. To the day, April 6th, AD 32, here comes Jesus Christ riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, the king, and they celebrated it. It was an amazing day. But notice here, as John pens for us, they didn't fully understand what was happening. They didn't get it. And my fear is that when Christ comes back again, people won't be ready. Even though there are signs of the times, we're not going to get it. We're not going to understand. But here is insight for us. Notice that there was prophecy. They had been told in advance. And in the same way, God told us in advance what it's going to be like when he returns. So we should be diligent to know these things, to understand these things. They should have known. They should have been prepared. And it tells us that in the last days before his return, that many will fall away. That's kind of scary. That's not good news. But he's told us in advance. So you have to be mindful of the things that you believe and practice. You want to know in whom you trust. And it's times like this when we reevaluate our faith. But if you go back to this story, by the looks of it, again, looks can be deceiving. They were ready. They were excited. They welcomed him, waving palm branches and shouting, "Hosanna! Oh, it's the Son of David." They called him the King of Israel. They did not understand, though, until later, what really was happening that day, even the disciples. You see, the problem was not how they were celebrating, it was for what reason they were celebrating. They were celebrating, fulfilling scripture, prophecy, as was foretold. All scripture will come to pass. As the Lord sends it forth, it will accomplish its work, right? They did not know, though, what the purpose was of Jesus riding into town, into Jerusalem that day. And you and I need to understand these things. You see, we call this entry into Jerusalem here on Palm Sunday, we call it, or we refer to it often, as Christ's triumphant entry into Jerusalem. But was it really something to celebrate? Was it really a day that we can remember as being victorious? His triumphant entry into Jerusalem? What happened with the crowds who wanted to follow him, who recognized him as their king a few days later, whenever he was being tried and convicted? An innocent man yet being accused guilty. Where were those crowds to stand to his defense? Something happened in less than a week. The crowds were no longer there to his support. These crowds adored Jesus. They celebrated Jesus. But did they fully understand and know Jesus? And I would say the same thing to the church. We celebrate, we adore him, but do we really know him? Again, even in the last day, many will say, Lord, Lord, but I've done this in your name. Perform many miracles. But Jesus will say, depart from me. I never knew you. And we know that that word used for knowing has to do with a continual growing in that relationship. You know, you can be acquainted with somebody and not know them intimately. You and I need to know Christ intimately as we are known. You notice here, they're celebrating Jesus. And we're excited about that because we know what's to follow Palm Sunday, Easter Sunday. But they didn't know what was going on. It tells us, too, that they took branches. Notice, palm branches. I thought about getting a bunch of palm branches for the kids to run around, but I didn't want to cause too much of a ruckus and get us in trouble, even though we're under great surveillance today. But you can do that at home with your kids. They're waving palm branches. It's very interesting because some 200 years prior to this date, there where Jesus had entered into Jerusalem, we know that the Israelites were delivered. The Jews were delivered by a man named Judas Maccabee. After 9 long years of battling the evil Antiochus Epiphanes, they overcame the Syrian army. And to follow this, they celebrated spontaneously, taking palm branches. Siri's wanting to interrupt my study here. Celebrating with palm branches that great deliverance that, as it says there, Judas Maccabee had provided for them. They were under oppression. They were being ridiculed. They were taken advantage of. In fact, we learn historically that he even entered into the temple and slaughtered a pig just to mock them in your face. And then Judas Maccabee rose up to deliver them. And it was a fierce battle. You can imagine what it would have taken 9 long years of battling against Antiochus Epiphanes. But he overcame the Syrian army. You think about that victory. It had become a tradition for the Jews, a symbol of deliverance from oppression. You could say in one sense that they were crying out, thinking just as Judas Maccabee had saved them before, now Jesus is going to save them from who? The Romans. But we know that this cry for Jesus as the King of Israel, the son of David, that their hope in him as their deliverer was wrong. Jesus was coming as the deliverer. He was coming as the Messiah. He was coming as the Savior, but not in the way that they had hoped. And that's why it only took a few days for them to gather. Ah, we had it all wrong. This guy's not really going to provide the deliverance that we need. Because they wanted to be delivered from the oppression of Rome. And little did they know that Jesus was coming to save them from their sins. Something that we all equally need saving from. We need to be washed and we need to be cleansed. And that penalty was going to be paid by Jesus on the cross, and his blood was going to be spilled in order to cleanse us of all our sins. They had no idea what Jesus the Christ was going to accomplish that week. And so they misunderstood what was taking place. But we also know this. Again, this is just historical context. This was a day of two processions. Not only is all of that going on, and you think about the history, we know that Pontius Pilate, around the year 30 AD, likely many believe the very same day, entered into Jerusalem on the western side, riding, of course, horseback, with soldiers to follow on foot. Each soldier, it tells us, was clad in leather armor, polished to high gloss. On each centurion's head, hammered helmets gleamed in the bright sunlight. At their sides, sheathed in their scabbards, were swords crafted from the hardest steel. And in their hands, each centurion carried a spear, or if he was an archer, a bow with a sling of arrows across his back. And then they would have had drummers beating out the cadence of march for this way. It would have been no ordinary entry into Jerusalem. It would have been one to exercise might and a power and authority. And it would make sense that Pontius Pilate, as Christ is entering from the east side of Jerusalem, that he would come in on the western side of Jerusalem with all his troops, because it's Passover and there are going to be thousands of people there, and it would have been necessary for the governor to show up and to show his authority and to put fear in the people. No rioting will be taking place this week. And you think about the two different processions. Again, think about Jesus and how he entered into Jerusalem. If Pilate's procession was meant to show military might and strength, Jesus' procession was meant to show the opposite. But the people didn't understand. It tells us both in Matthew and Mark's gospel that by Jesus' own words, he had instructed his disciples to go into the city and to find a donkey tied up. And they were to ask the owner if they could use the donkey. And they were to say to the owner, "The Lord has need of him." That was Jesus' instructions. Again, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. It was his choice to enter into Jerusalem that day in the way that he did. Even though you and I know Jerusalem, and even today, deserves Jesus Christ on a white horse. Yet he chose to come in that manner. As we read, Jesus finding a young donkey, he sat on it. And then it says, as it is written, verse 15, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." John quotes from Zechariah, the 9th chapter. It says there, "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." When you look at that passage in Zechariah 9, he says this in verses 8 through 10, "I will defend my house against marauding forces. Never again will an oppressor overrun my people. For now I am keeping watch. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem." And then it says, what we have quoted for us by John. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding a donkey on the colt, the foal of a donkey. In other words, John's quote from the prophet Zechariah reminded those who heard him of that entire passage. What was the context there? The message they were hearing was God is going to deliver the nation of Israel from their oppressor. And they could shout Hosanna to that. They could shout, they could celebrate. And in this case, again, they're thinking of Rome. They're not thinking of their own wickedness and the depravity of man's heart. They're not thinking of sin. They're thinking about Rome. After all, they're worse than we are, right? But again, the king that we are remembering today came humbly, not on a steed of war, but on a slow-moving donkey. Have you ever ridden a donkey? It's quite a humbling experience. I'll never forget having that experience in a small country in Albania where they still use today as, you know, transportation and all kinds of services for the community. That's what he chose to ride. And they make funny noises too. Right, kids? But this was a symbol from our king that he comes in peace, even according to Zechariah. And so these two processions couldn't be more different in the messages that they convey if you think about in the contrasting ideas and the purposes that they serve. Pilate led Roman centurions. He asserted power and might of the entire empire of Rome there in Jerusalem, ready to crush whoever would oppose him. Jesus, he embodied peace and tranquility, that the shalom, that shalom of God, and he brought that to all of his people. Those who watched that day and even celebrate that day, and we look back at it, we celebrate it for a different reason. We have to make a choice. Jesus offers peace, and we have to make a choice. Do we want to serve the God of this world, a God of might and power, the God of mammon, maybe wealth? Or are we willing to serve the God of peace, the king who represents a different kingdom, the kingdom of God? It tells us in verse 16 that these things his disciples did not understand at first, but when Jesus was glorified, then it says they remembered that these things were written of him and that they had done these things to him. They didn't get it, simply put. And that really shocked me when I first read that. They didn't understand. How could John write this there? But there's a secret for us. He's giving us insight from the inside of their ring. They didn't get it till after he was glorified. Matthew's gospel records a similar tone. It says even there that he cried out, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. They should have known. Remember the prophecy in Zechariah. But they didn't get it. Why? Their expectations were wrong. And how often do we miss the mark when we have the wrong expectations? One of the first things we address, right, in premarital counseling is, let's talk about expectations so that we don't miss the mark. And how often do we come to God with the false expectations? Or our expectations are misguided, but he's told us what to expect and why to expect him in this way. Jesus, the Christ. I love this story because we're reminded of the love of God, the sacrifice of Jesus, and the purpose that he served in coming in the humble way that he did. You see, this is always a Sunday in each year. We can study these scriptures. We can be encouraged by these scriptures and be reminded that Jesus stands at the door and he knocks. He wants to enter into our hearts, and you and I know he's bringing shalom. He's bringing peace. He comes to you in this way, and it's up to us to invite him in. He won't force his way in. You see, that's the way Pontius Pilate was demonstrating his authority. God is not going to force his way into your heart. And he's not going to force his way into the hearts of man even now. We have to understand this. Remember how Jesus works. Remember that he brings gifts. The greatest gift is eternal life. He said all who would receive him. He gives the gift of eternal life. And this is what it's all about. This is what he has accomplished. This is what the prophecy of Zechariah was foretelling and what Jesus was fulfilling. That Christ was going to provide for us a type of peace and a type of deliverance that would set us apart from all the world. We would enter into now his kingdom. And forever we'll be with him. As you know, the prophecies even in Isaiah that say on his government, upon his government, there will be no end in his rule. And so that's how Jesus is ruling today. He rules the hearts and the minds of those who have received him. He rules the church. We, the people of God, have the peace of God because we've received Christ, the Messiah, on a donkey. But remember that at the same time as we celebrate these things and we remember these things and we are encouraged and we're comforted, we're reassured of our salvation, remember too that he's foretold about his second return, that he's going to come again. And this time when he comes, it's going to be to judge the nations. And so you have the opportunity now to bow your knees to him, to humble yourselves to him, before him. Because one day when he comes in that way, it says that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. All will one day worship him. But you have the choice now to do it willingly, to humble yourselves. This is the invitation. That's why he stands at the door and he knocks. And you think about what is provided. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You and I can shout that. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Why? And he brings those blessings. We celebrate that today. And it's an encouragement, but at the same time, a warning. And I can't help but give that warning that we take it to heart and we think about those around us. You see, the invitation is there. We need to choose this day whom we will serve. Are we ready to serve God? Are we willing to serve God? Are we prepared to serve God? Because he's already made the way. The way is free. Jesus paved the way. And in him we have peace. And then think about the troubles that we're facing now. As we've been reflecting on those promises of God and being reassured of those promises and the blessed hope, we also have been reminded to take heart and be encouraged and then be filled with the Holy Spirit. You see, because the world is filled with temptation, is filled with trouble, and even now, following that, can come a lot of fear and anxiety, but you can have peace in God when the God of peace is ruling your heart. And so that's the invitation, that's the challenge, and that is the gift of God. And that is something that we have to be reminded of, and we take a moment every year to remember as a church. That's the exhortation. Remember how Jesus entered into Jerusalem. In closing, I wanted to leave with you guys a couple of verses in 1 Peter. Because in all of this, as I started in 1 John, I want to close in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. We know that the end is at hand. His return is imminent. So how should we prepare? And we've encouraged. Listen, be diligent to pray. Notice what Peter says in chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. But the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious, watchful in your prayers, and above all things, have fervent love for one another. For love will cover a multitude of sins. The end is near. And it's my job to tell you this, to remind you of this, although you already know. Listen, notice, I like that translation. I don't know what yours might say there. To be vigilant, maybe. Sober-minded. It says, be serious. Take advantage of the time you have. Don't waste it. And certainly, there is temptation to do that. To become complacent and not to think of it so seriously. But notice, he says, be serious and watchful in your prayers. That's an exhortation we can all take to heart, because the end is at hand. And there are so many around us who do not know Christ, who have not been introduced to that Messiah who's bringing peace until the end. He offers peace until that day, because when he comes then, it's judgment. There is a difference. Above all things, have fervent love for one another. Right thinking leads to right behaving. And this is a time where we have to reevaluate our thought life. True thoughts leads to true action. Think about the deceiving thoughts, the discouraging thoughts. It will lead to deceived action and discouragement. You think about the seeds that are being sown in your mind and in your heart, and why there's fear. Well, you sow to the flesh and you reap corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, you reap life, and there is encouragement. There is a reason why you and I can anticipate his return, and with joy and excitement. Notice that our love for one another will cover the multitude of sins. So this is a time when we are to be out exercising that love fervently, diligently, looking for ways to bless those around us, looking for ways to serve those around us. Love covers a multitude of sins. It's you and I. He's sent as his ambassadors, as his extension of his kingdom now, bringing peace, bringing the gospel of peace. It's good news. Remember, we're out there to proclaim this. This is what the Christ has come and he's delivered and he's brought. Because you don't want to meet him for the first time then. You want to know him now intimately. You can bow your knees to him now and your heart to him now, or you'll do it later. Rather do it now so that you can have peace with God and experience the peace of God. And you can go through all of these difficult times with that kind of hope. Let your hope be fixed in heaven, church. Be sober, be sound, be devoted to prayer, love one another fervently. These are the words I want to leave with you. Because Christ has come, and he's coming again. Amen? So this is how we are to apply ourselves in this day that we're living. Amen? Amen. Let's close in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the reminder that you are a God of hope. Lord, that you are a God of comfort, and that you have given us hope. Hope in the return of Christ, but also, Lord, hope for today. Lord, help us to have our joy renewed in our salvation. Help us, Lord, to Look not to ourselves or our circumstances, but look to heaven, where our help comes from and where our hope is fixed. Help us to take joy in you and in these things, so that, Lord, we can live it out for those around us who need to hear the gospel of truth, because these days are filled with fear. We know, God, that you want to encourage, that you want to warn us of the things leading up to this and the things that are to follow, so that we would know you and know you personally, so that we would have you, Lord, in our hearts, that we would be filled with peace, having peace with you, having peace to endure all of these circumstances. So, Lord, help us to lay all the things aside that are weighing us down, so that we can run the race that you've set before us. We can live for you in these times, being the salt and light in our community and in our world. Help the church now, Lord, rise to the occasion, to not go, to, you know, be filled with fear behind closed doors, but Lord, that we would be bold in going out to preach the gospel of peace and administering, Lord, the gift that you, our Prince of Peace, has given, the salvation that you've provided. Lord, we take heart in that, join that today as a church, and we celebrate that. And we thank you, Lord, that we could be out here to celebrate that together. We pray, Father, for you to end the spread of this virus in our world, in our nation, and in our community. Lord, that you would be merciful.
Destined to die.
said, in this world you will have tribulation. But then he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Amen?
Amen.
Real quick, just a couple of announcements. Just want to tell you guys, we have gloves, if you guys need any, inside the, for you. And we've put in an order for masks. I know they're in high demand and short in supply. To my knowledge, there, you know, obviously there are a lot of videos and ways that you can make them at home, but we just wanted you to know we put it in order so you guys, well, there'll be some here for you. And I was just notified that there's been a warning out to be very, very careful when you're out using the gas stations, especially there to use gloves and things like that. So let's continue to be encouraged, to encourage one another, to be safe and mindful of all that's going on. Precaution is necessary for what's, you know, the spread of this virus. And we'll take every advantage that we can, being precautious with the health and safety measures, but also taking some bold steps of faith like today to gather. And as we sent out in the email that we're gonna be opening the facility because that's allowed, the worship places are allowed to be visited for purposes of worship and prayer. We're gonna open up the sanctuary. We're gonna sanitize it continually before and after, but that you guys could come here if you'd like to just pray, to get away in the middle of your day, in the morning, or even in the evening after work. There'll be different times we're gonna send that out to you guys so that you know the sanctuary is available to you to just get away and take time to pray because we need the day approaches, amen? God bless you guys. Thanks for coming out. We look forward to seeing you next week at the latest for Easter.
Let me hit finish. Sarah, there, you got it?